Sambatskano Mongol Chuda, and welcome to Talk With Me.
Otko Chulu was born in 1978 in Ulaanbaatar. Today, he's the head of strategic policy and planning at Mongolia's Ministry of Mining and Energy. He's also a board member of Oyu Tolgoi, which is, of course, the largest financial undertaking in Mongolia's history and is expected, upon completion, to account for more than 30% of the country's gross domestic product. Otko Chulu was head of market research with Haas Bank and also served as an advisor to the President of Mongolia from 2009 to 2010. Otko Chulu's childhood was spent under the short period of socialist economic success, but also during the years of political uncertainty which eventually followed in Mongolia. He's made a personal commitment to empowering community capacity in order to bring positive economic transformation to the people of Mongolia.
This morning I have Otko Chulu, who is the Director General at the Department of Strategic Policy and Planning at the Ministry of Mining.
Otko Chulu, Oglonimend.
Oglonimend.
Sakhamersno.
Sakha. Tenel Seno.
San. Now, tell me, Otko, I want to discuss many things with you today, but briefly, can you run me through what's been happening lately at the Ministry of Mining and how your work is?
The Ministry of Mining is one of the newly created ministry in response to that mining sector itself become the major driver of the economy, and also it's the main door to go to international markets. So the new ministry is established and with main goal to achieve the legal reform towards to more market economy and to create an investor-friendly environment, etc. So last 2 years were very busy year for us. We are late approved the minerals policy and 4 different laws, especially law on petroleum and minerals law, amendment in minerals law. And it was passed and we have to now start to work to implement it. We have to prepare for issuing new licenses, etc. And also we are right now working on 2 different laws. First one is law on EITI. It means Extractive Industry Transparency Initiative. So in future we want to have more transparent and responsible mining sector. And we do need the public education and public awareness what's the impact of the mining sector to the economy. And another law is a subsoil law. It's important to increase the subsoil law.
Subsoil
law. Because we have a huge wealth underground and we have to have a consolidated coordination and database. We have hard minerals and it has own law and own agency. We have petroleum law, we have Petroleum Authority of Mongolia, it's different agency. We have Nuclear Energy Agency, we have Water Authority, but we think there should be a coordinated, consolidated geological information. So to make it happen, we have to renew that law and modernize it, because that law is very old, it's older than our constitution.
Really?
The subsoil law, yeah.
Otko Chulu, you're also on the board of Oyu Tolgoi, and I know the last few weeks have been very busy for you. For foreigners who are watching this program, Oyu Tolgoi is the largest undertaking in Mongolia, financial mining project that when it is completed is expected to account for 30% of Mongolia's GDP. So I know there's been a bit of conflict in recent months. Can you give us an update on Oyu Tolgoi and what's happening with the Mongolian government and Rio Tinto?
Oyu Tolgoi is one of the big achievements in our current history. So within 2 years, we made together with our investors the world-class mine. And it was logistically a masterpiece because there was a lot of inputs from everywhere of the world. There were a lot of workers working together to achieve that great success. And right now, the open pit and concentrator is working very well. We can place our products in successfully in the markets, and marketing and sales operation is on track. It's going very well, pretty well. But we have to understand that Oyutlo is integral deposits. It has many different ore bodies. It's like a group of deposits, you know. And in some layers, in some deposits, the underground development is already almost done. There's huge shafts, there is huge tunnels, and it reached 15 kilometers, etc. What we are talking right now, it's one special area. It's we call this Hyuga Damit. It's one.
Could you say that word again?
Hyuga Damit. It was called by the geologist who found that, and it will happen from 16 to 19. These main construction, especially on that ore body, and we are now talking about financing this section.
Yeah.
Look. You can compare Oyutlo construction like you are building a 15-stock or 15-floor skyline. And now we have made these basements, first floor is ready, and now we are only talking about the second floor, something like this. And with or without this funding, Oyutlo is a huge project, and this underground mine construction will be continue same as with the lifeline of lifetime of the project.
And will funding proceed? Everything's going as planned.
Yeah, it's everything is as planned. Just few days ago, the Mongolian board members received the feasibility study, and we will the Oyutlo company will give it officially to the Minerals Council. It's the body which should review it and accept this.
Right.
And after that, we can continue to restart the underground mine development.
Okay. And you think, Otko Chulu, that perhaps Mongolia is coming to a turning point? I mean, with the positive news about the continuation of Oyutlo, you see Mongolia coming to a turning point?
Yes, I see that, because I saw the foreign trade, we say economists say it's current account balance. I saw the last official foreign trade statistics, and it was unexpectedly very good. We performed some good things, at least by trade. So we exported more. And also the export from mineral sector, it's growing, even despite these prices falling down in two straight lines.
The coal prices?
Yeah, coal price, and the prices are not good in international markets. Even though our reaction was good and we are sustaining our export volume, it's a good achievement. Also, last month, we received more than 30 requests on oil and gas sector to sign exploration licenses or exploration agreements. And shortly we will accept the requests and tender materials to issue a new mining licenses, exploration licenses.
So investor confidence is coming back?
Yeah, I hope so, because there is many signs telling that. And I reviewed some international law journals or magazines, and they say Mongolia made a good step on reforming the oil and gas sector laws. I think they were pretty happy with the new law on oil and gas and also minerals law.
So Otko Chulu, you've been very busy. You sort of deserve a long holiday now.
Yes.
Are you tired?
Yeah, last year I didn't have enough time to go to countryside or to take vacation, but it's okay. Main thing is we have to do many things now, and we don't waste time anymore, because there's a lot of young people and also experienced people, they are waiting to work again, because the current situation is overall the worldwide we are facing a downturn of mining sector. The big mining giants also they are making some hard steps like decreasing the number of workforce, etc. So we are facing some problem, mm-hmm. but we have to react and we have to encourage the business mm-hmm. To hire more. So for that, yeah, we have to work even more hard. And
well, I think you're working very hard. You definitely deserve a nice break in the countryside. Otko, I can call you Otko, I hope. I know your full name is Chulun Tseren Otko Chulu, but I thank you for letting me call you Otko. Your history is fascinating. We were chatting just before the show started, and Otko Chulu actually taught himself English, and I only speak one language. I pretend I can speak Mongolian, but your English is amazing for someone who is self-taught, and you speak German, a little bit of Russian. How did you do this?
Thank you very much. So, I learned Russian in school. I graduated at Mongolian school, and that time was it's when I was young. There was a structural change. Mm-hmm. Lot of teachers just left over, and they went to small trading.
Yes.
And there was lot of lessons and classes was just dismissed, etc. Mm-hmm. And then I went to Germany and I learned German there in Germany. And I came back and I worked here with many expats here.
Have the expats taught you?
Yes.
And have you met any Australians? Have you learned any Australian English?
I previously I was working by Economic Research Institute, mm-hmm. and I was the manager, and I had two Australian young ambassadors. So there was a program, mm-hmm. and I had one of them, mm-hmm. and I have to communicate with them. So my German helped me to improve.
So your German helped you to learn English.
Yeah. First, mm-hmm. I just used German sentence structure, replacing the words, and then gradually I learned the sentence structure. Mm-hmm.
It's been very hard for me learning Mongolian with the sentence structure, the verb at the end. You have to reorganize the way you think, don't you? Otko Chulu, Otko, tell me about your recollections of Mongolia. I know you were born in 1978. But what are your recollections of Mongolia pre-1990, before the switch to democracy? What was it like a young boy growing up in UB under Soviet times?
So, my childhood, it was in that time, the Mongolia had a different regime. Socialist and central planned economy, etc. And I was like pioneer. It says like this, the small children, they have to join a membership of like this pioneer organization.
Can you say that word again?
Pioneer.
Oh, yes, no, that's not, yeah, like a youth movement.
Yeah, youth movement. Yeah, and we have to have this red, we say it's tie or galstuk.
Like a scarf.
Yeah. Uh-huh. And the first time I joined this pioneer organization, that was one of my happiest moments because I was very proud of myself, you know. There was two opportunities to join these. Group. Mm-hmm. First, the birthday of Lenin or birthday of Sukhbatar.
And right. The birthday of Sukhbatar.
Yeah, one is in February, another one is, I think, in April or something like this. Mm-hmm. And who has very good grades, mm-hmm. they are chosen to join this group first in February. And I was one of them.
Which one did you join, the Lenin group or the Sukhbatar group?
Yeah, first one. I forgot.
But you are so studious and good at school that you are able to join this pioneer movement. What sort of activities did you do during, what were you involved in? What did you do?
We have to help the older people, and in summertime we have to collect some grasses or kind of grasses, mm-hmm. to give it later to herders, etc. And mm-hmm. in winter time, we have to help to have like these some materials to keep warm the young baby animals, etc. So something like this. I think it was very useful. You know?
It sounds useful. I mean, Otkochili, I remember a few years ago you shared a story with me about learning a song that your mother taught you about the first, probably the only Mongolian cosmonaut. What are your memories of that song? And tell me about it.
Yeah, it's very, how would say, I cannot recall everything, but one of what I can recall from my very young memory is that song. It says, the brother astronaut mm-hmm. will come back into Earth, etc. Mm-hmm. And the sound is very good. My mother teach that, and maybe that was one of my first song.
Amazing. Have you ever met this man?
I met him. But not here in Mongolia. Gururakhche. He's the hero, Mongolian hero.
I'd love to meet him one day. Otkochili, your childhood was spent under socialism, but also you remember the 1990 peaceful revolution. What happened after that revolution? I mean, Mongolia changed very dramatically. Tell me about that time.
So that time was I was a young child, and I didn't realize that my parents were very panicking. They mm-hmm. said, okay, now it's nothing is secure, you know. Mm-hmm. And the Great Soviet Union is collapsed. Mm-hmm. There is no trade anymore because the 90% of Mongolian trade and almost 90% of Mongolian GDP was...
I remember you telling me once when Boris Yeltsin stormed the Kremlin, that was a really bad day for you, and you remembered...
Because, you know, that time, a lot of children dreamed to study in Moscow, to be like party member and recognized. Mm-hmm. And if they grow up, they can have black cars like Chaika or Volga. That was a Russian mm-hmm. luxury cars that time. Yeah, and every children dreamed that they can one day grow up and having this like black hair and sitting the old parents there and going through Psukhvater Square, etc. Because in the socialist time, that was the best you can achieve. You can have an education in Moscow and then come back and then you can go forward with socialist success, etc. But then there's democratic movements and everything was wrong, something like this. And
Otko, you have a Bachelor of Economics degree from the Technical University of Dresden, Master's degree, University of Frankfurt, very well traveled all over the world. What was it like going overseas as a young Mongolian university student? What did you learn overseas that you have brought back to Mongolia?
I have chosen Germany because we had a long tradition, and also in socialist time, the East Germany and Mongolia, there was very good bridge on the education. Mm-hmm. And I went to Dresden and I learned German there.
Mm-hmm. Were your studies in German?
Yes.
So you went to Germany without speaking German and had to learn German?
I have done some preliminary courses, so. And then I went to Dresden. It was still, it was a former East German. There was still huge difference between the former East Germany and West Germany. Mm-hmm. And I realized that in Germany, the university is different. In Mongolia, when I was a student, I have to make a lot of homeworks. Mm-hmm. And every day I have late to check them. Mm-hmm. But in Germany, you have total freedom. Mm. You can visit class, you don't appear there, it's okay. Mm-hmm. But at the end, you have to pass the exam. Mm. That's the most hard thing. Yeah. So the student has a lot of freedom. Mm-hmm. He or she can select his timing. Mm-hmm. And in Germany, the system is different. They teaching how to learn. Mm. It's learning by learning, you know. In Mongolia, that time, you have to receive what the teacher said. Right, right. In Germany, that was different. You have to create your own knowledge, you know. So it was, yeah. And that was, for me, a cultural shock. But I did overcome that.
Otkochula, I know you're very hardworking and you studied very hard. Did you have fun in Germany? Did you ever go out and have fun and explore? Was it study? What did you have fun?
Yeah, I had fun. Every Saturday I enjoy some beers with my friends.
Some bratwurst?
Yes, bratwurst and looking social or football. That was very fun.
Festivals?
Football. And then during my vacation, I went to many countries because you have, if you have Schengen visa, you can travel many countries there. So for students, there is a lot of opportunities. You can take a bus, a regional bus. Mm-hmm. It's not so expensive. Mm-hmm. And even if you have luck, you can find discounts. You can fly to Turkey or New York, mm-hmm. very cheap price. There is some discounts for students.
So you did this all by yourself? You weren't married at the time?
No, I did it myself. And of course, I made some job in, how it say this work. I work
so
with old money.
Yeah, part-time jobs.
Yeah, yeah.
Money for beer.
Yeah, and to travel. Yeah.
Otko, when you came back to Mongolia, you worked at Hasbank, very high-profile job, and you also became an advisor to President Elbek Dorju. Did many amazing things when you came back. Citizen education in finance and economics issues are very important to you. Why is it important to you, and what are you doing to change things?
Yeah, because you know. I had some cultural shocks in Germany, and when I returned back in Mongolia, also there was another cultural shock. Oh. After 8 years in Germany, I didn't recognize the UBA anymore. That mm-hmm. was totally changed, and people's mentalities are also changed. Mm-hmm. And what I have realized is this strong democracy and the market economy, it cannot go ahead with public education, because there should be a critical mass that they have to understand the economy and what the financial markets going on etc. Especially during my time in Hasbank, I traveled a lot of the countrysides. I visited
in the Mongolian countryside. Tell me what your title at Hasbank was. It was
Market Research Unit Manager. Mm-hmm. My job was I have to make macroeconomic evaluations. Mm-hmm. Economic reports, and then I have to go to the customers or potential customers and to ask their demands, mm-hmm. and ask their failures. And I learned many things, because in these micro level or micro level, mm-hmm. I would say, a lot of households and borrowers, lenders, they have some lack of financial educations.
Yes, yes.
And they borrow a lot of money, and by repayment there is huge problems.
And they don't know how to manage the funds, right?
So, because the Mongolian banking market is very saturated, the competition getting in always fiercer. So mm-hmm. then the Hasbank pushed to go niche markets, open new markets, mm-hmm. New segments. And it was more poor segments, mm-hmm. but they did have some extra work, because financial education is needed.
Yes.
So you have to combine something. So that was my main job, and it was very amazing. And
how many years were you with Hasbank for?
Two years there.
Otko, what do you miss most, going back to your childhood, what do you miss most about being a young kid in Mongolia, something that you had in your childhood that's no longer here in UB?
When I was a child, the streets were very safe. Mm. There was no traffic jams. The air was very clean. You have always fresh air. And you can play from from early morning to late night.
Yes, without being wiped out by a bus.
Yes. And also in winter time was very good. So you can play hockey, etc. And you can go to the rivers to swim. Mm-hmm. But now it's not possible. Now it's for children, it's even in winter time, it's dangerous to breathe, you know.
Yes.
So I miss that. And also UP was very small and clean, very structured. But now it's it's like so growing bigger and
What are your hopes for the future of Mongolia? Where do you hope Mongolia? How do you see Mongolia 10 years from now?
I'm very optimistic because this week and last week I heard a lot of good news in sport and also in mind sport like chess, intelligent issues and etc. And it's not only sports. We have a world-class miners here. And in the last 5 years, Mongolia attracted foreign direct investments many times than its own GDP. So no country have achieved such success. So Mongolians itself, the citizens, very competitive by sport, by education, etc. And also the Mongolian economy is getting more open. We had some mistakes, but we are learning.
Yes.
And important is you have showed to people, you have some learning curves.
Yes.
Because every country had such mistakes. United States, Australia, Germany, UK. So most important thing is we have to show that we understand our mistakes and we try to don't repeat it. And we want to play according to international standards. And the new generation is very promising, you know.
What do you think about foreigners living in UB? What are your thoughts about the expat community?
They are very strong, you know, very strong. Because sometimes I feel it's even hard for Mongolians to live here in UB because of this traffic jam, air pollution. And it's not so cheap place to live, you know. It's getting more expensive, and the competition's getting fierce, you know.
Yeah.
It's very dynamic. Sometimes it's good. Sometimes the security is not there.
Yeah. Oscar, I want to ask you another quick question. I'm going to wrap it up soon, but you are very well-read man, and you have just joined an organization called Open Mind Mongolia. Can you tell me about that?
I was very active. When I was a student in Germany, I opened an online debating forum or something like this, young economists. And I also joined the Tsakhemurto.
Can you say that again?
Tsakhemurto.
Uh-huh.
It's the biggest community among the Mongolians living abroad.
Uh-huh.
It's a global community. After I returned back, I have also joined some communities. Some of them was successful, some of them not okay. And I also I'm one of the initiators of this so-called program, Beehive, Zuginur, Beehive.
Beehive?
Yeah, Beehive. It was supposed to support the Mongolians who returned back to Mongolia, to offer them specialized loans, mortgages or support them financially, etc. And then another project was this Mind Club. There was some alumni gathered together, and we have chosen some books. And first book we have chosen was Who Am I? It was
Who Am I?
Yeah. It was written by a German philosopher, a young philosopher. Richard Precht, and very amazing book.
Yeah,
it was a bestseller in Europe.
Yes, I've seen it on your on the Open Mind Mongolia website, but I can't get it in English in UB.
I have one.
Can I borrow it?
Sure.
Okay,
I have in English, I have in German, I have in Mongolian.
And you can read all of them, but I can't, I just need the English copy.
And we have translated from Germany to Mongolian. I was responsible for first and last chapter. And then we have compared it with the English. For me, it was very funny and amazing because I can refresh my German, mm-hmm. and also I can improve my English.
Otko, thank you very much for joining us today on Talk With Me. You're a fascinating man. And I hope I see you again. Maybe come on again next year.
Sure.
Thank you. Thank you, viewers, for joining us today on Talk With Me. I hope to see you next week. Bayır Steyn Dara Oltsi.